Whenever we hear the sound of the bell, we practice listening to the bell deeply. Usually when someone invite the bell to sound, we don't say hit the bell, we say invite the bell to sound. He or she should wake the bell up first with a half sound, like this. That is a half sound. But before he does that, she does that, she has to practice mindful breathing first to prepare himself. And there is a verse for the bell master to use for breathing in and breathing out and to make himself or herself available to the bell, qualified as a bell master. You just cannot pick up the instrument and then you make the sound. You have to prepare yourself. So holding the may I borrow it? Holding the stick like this, you will practice mindful breathing. A few times in order to calm himself down, to make him or her into a real bell master. And the verse is like this. Body, speech and mind in perfect oneness. I send my heart along with the sound of this bell. May the hearers awaken from their forgetfulness and transcend the path of anxiety and sorrow. See, that is a four-line verse for you to breathe and to become a real bell master. Body, speech and mind in perfect oneness. I send my heart along with the sound of this bell. May the hearers awaken from their forgetfulness and transcend the path of anxiety and sorrow. And then you are calm. You are fully aware. You are fully present. And now you can invite the bell to sound. You invite, you offer half a sound, so that the whole community become aware that a real sound, a full sound is going to be heard. And everyone stop thinking, stop talking, prepare themselves to receive the full sound, the voice of the Buddha calling you back to your true home. In a practice center, the sound of the bell is the voice of the Buddha from within calling you back to your true home. And so the bell master make a half sound and allow you the time to prepare yourself for the reception of the full sound, the voice of the Buddha. You stop what you are saying, you finish what you are saying in a few seconds, you stop your thinking. Not only your talking, but you stop also your thinking. You go home to yourself with your in-breath and you enjoy breathing to get prepared for the sound as the voice of the Buddha from within calling you back to your true home. And then the bell master will allow you the time to for one in breath, one out breath at least, and then he or she will invite the bell so that a full sound will be offered to the whole community. And then everyone will enjoy breathing in and breathing out at least three times. And when you breathe in, you say, I listen, I listen. And when you breathe out, you say, this wonderful sound brings me back to my true home. Listen, listen. This wonderful sound brings me back to my true home. No thinking, just listening, listening very deeply to the sound of the bell that will bring you back to your true home in the here and the now. And the one who speaks stops speaking and thinking about what to say next and enjoy deeply his or her in-breath and out-breath. Enjoy his being in his true home. That is the living Dharma. Being in your true home. And the one who listens to the talk also stop listening and enjoy her in-breath and out-breath. Very nourishing, very in. In Plum Village in France, not only we enjoy the sound of the great bell within our center, but whenever the bell, the church bell nearby sound, we also stop and enjoy the church bell. Not only we enjoy the church bell, but every time the clock play the music, every quarter of the hour, we also stop thinking, stop talking, and we go back to our breath, and we enjoy breathing in and out. Whether we are in the dining hall or in the kitchen, we do the same. So the clock, the music of the clock, is like the mindfulness bell, help us to come home and to enjoy our home. Also, when you hear the telephone ringing, you practice. You are supposed not to run to the telephone. You are supposed to stay wherever you are, because the sound of the telephone is also the voice of the Buddha calling back you back to your true home. Stay wherever you are and go back to your in-breath. Listen, listen. This wonderful sound brings me back to my true home. And then after having practiced like that two times, you do walking meditation to the telephone, or you take the telephone out and answer. And if you are the one who is called, who want to make the phone call, you prepare yourself before making the number. You practice going home to yourself. And there is also a verse for you to practice. Verses, words can travel thousands of kilometers. They are to bring about more understanding, mutual understanding. I vow that what I am going to say will be beautiful, like flowers and embroideries. I vow that everything I'm going to say will help with more mutual understanding and compassion. And then now you are qualified to make a phone call. And when you hear, and when you hear the sound at the end of the line, you know that the other person is listening, breathing in and out, and you know that you have a chance to practice breathing in and out with her. So both of you are breathing in and out mindfully at the same time. It's a very beautiful practice. We call it telephone meditation. And then in Plum Village, in the Deer Park Monastery also, if we use the computer is programmed so that every quarter of the hour there will be a bell of mindfulness so that you can stop your work and go home and enjoy your in-breath and out-breath. And you know that when you call Plum Village or Deer Park, you don't expect them to answer right away after the first ring. They are breathing in and out. Listen, this wonderful sound brings me back to my true home. And you enjoy deeply your in-breath and out-breath three times. The bell master tonight is a monk from New Zealand. Brother Pháp Điền, the field of the Dharma. Enjoy the mindfulness bell. Enjoy your in-breath and out-breath three times. Or you might like to say, I listen deeply. This wonderful sound brings me back to my true home. Or you might say, breathing in, I feel calm, I relax. Breathing out, I smile. Calming, smiling. Breathing in, I establish myself in the present moment. Breathing out, I know this is a wonderful moment. Calming, smiling. Present moment. Wonderful moment. When you come home to the present moment with your in-breath, you become fully alive, fully present. You can touch life in the here and the now. You feel that you are alive. You touch the miracle that you are alive. Because to be alive, that is the greatest of all miracles. And with only one in-breath, you can touch that miracle. That is why you can say, present moment, wonderful moment. If someone asks you, my dear friend, has the most wonderful moment of your life arrived? He wants to know whether the most wonderful moment of your life has arrived. It would be a pity if such a moment does not arrive at all. Then you may have the tendency to say, oh, it does not seem that it has arrived, that wonderful moment. But I'm sure that it will arrive soon, sometime in the future. And that is our tendency to answer. But if we keep living like the way we have lived our life in the past 20 years, it will not arrive in the next 20 years. It might not arrive at all, that moment we call the most wonderful moment of our life. And for many, many of us, that moment does not arrive at all. Until we die. The Buddha said, you have to make the present moment into the most wonderful moment of your life. And this is possible. Because if you are able to go home to the present moment, to the here and the now, become fully alive, become fully present, you can touch all the wonders of life within yourself and around you. Everything belonging to you is a wonder. Your eye, your ear, your nose, your body, your mind. And because you are not mindful, you don't touch them deeply, you don't know that they are wonders until you die. And you begin to regret that you have not lived at all. That is why our true home must be sought in the here and the now. It can be touched in the here and the now. My true home is not limited to a place. To a time. My true home is not Vietnam. My true home is not France. My true home is not America. My true home is not Africa. My true home is not the Palestine. My true home is not Israel. Although they don't let me go back to Vietnam, I still have my true home available in the here and the now. And maybe they are in Vietnam, but they don't have a home. That is why I don't feel as a victim. And I don't feel that they are my enemies. They are victims of fear. They believe that if I go home, I will create an atmosphere of solidarity, of friendship, of brotherhood that may be threatening to their power. And it is fear. That is an obstacle. And I want to help them to be free from fear. They are not my enemies. They are the ones I want to help. They are object of my practice of compassion and understanding. I have no enemies. During the war, during the Vietnam War, it was so difficult for us to voice our concern. Most of us did not want the war. The war put us in a situation where brothers have to kill brothers and kill with foreign weapons and ideologies. Communism and anti-communism are imported, were imported. Also weapons used by the communists were imported. Weapons used by anti-communists were imported. So they gave us guns and ideologies and urged us to fight each other and kill each other. We started a movement called Don't Shoot Your Brother. And our voice was silenced by both sides of the both warring parties. We try to speak out. We try to tell you in the world that we don't want the war. We don't want the killing of each other with foreign weapons and foreign ideologies. And yet we were forced to do so. So those of us who practice mindfulness, understanding and compassion, we did not want to accept the war. We wanted to reconcile. And our voice was not allowed to be heard. Sometimes we have to burn ourselves alive in order to get the message across. Thích Quảng Đức, a friend of mine, one day he burned himself, and his picture appeared in the international press. I was in New York, and I saw that picture in the New York Times front page. It's a friend of mine. Nhất Chi Mai, one of the first six members of the Order of Interbeing, my disciple, she burned herself calling for reconciliation. She went to the Tư Nghiêm Temple in very early in the morning, about 2-3 o'clock in the morning. She put a statue of the Virgin Mary and Kuan Yin. She left behind a set of letters calling for the president of North Vietnam, the president of South Vietnam, for everyone to come together and stop the act of killing each other. And then she doused herself with gasoline and she burned herself. Nhất Chi Mai is a very close sister, close friend of Sư Cô Chân Không, Sister Chân Không, True Emptiness. I was in Paris. She left behind a letter for me. Thầy, don't worry. Peace will come. Don't suffer too much. Don't worry. She was about to die, but she tried to comfort me, her teacher. It's very, very difficult for us to voice our concern. Although we are the majority in the country, we did not want the war. My book of poetry, peace poetry, I like to call it peace poetry rather than anti-war poetry. It was condemned by the North and confiscated by the South. So when Cornell University invited me to come and make a series of lectures, I took the opportunity to go out and to call for peace. And in June the 1st, In the year 1966. I met Martin Luther King in Chicago. Exactly 1 year before. Exactly 1 year before. On June 1st, 1965, I wrote him a letter explaining to him why we had burned ourselves. This is not an act of suicide. This is an act of love. You want to transmit a message, but you have no other ways. You have to burn yourself in order for your message to get across. So the suffering of the monk who burned herself to get the message across, message of love and compassion. It's of the same nature of the act of Jesus Christ dying on the cross. Dying with no hate, no anger, only with compassion. Leaving behind a compassionate call for peace, for brotherhood. So exactly 1 year after I met him in Chicago, we talked for some time, and then after that, we went out to meet with the press. And that day he came out against the war in Vietnam. And that day, that is the day when we combined our efforts of working for peace in Vietnam and fighting for civil rights in America. Two years later, I met him again in Geneva. In a conference called Pax Seminaris, organized by the World Council of Churches. There are people like Linus Pauling at the conference. He stayed in the 11th floor. I was on the 4th floor. He invited me up for breakfast. I was retained by the press. I came up late. And he kept the breakfast warm for me and waited for me. I told him, Martin, you know something? In Vietnam, they call you a bodhisattva. They call you a bodhisattva, an enlightened being. Trying to awaken other living beings and help them go in the direction of compassion and understanding. I'm glad I had the chance to tell him because a few months later he was assassinated in Memphis. We were in France. We had a bureau, an office representing the Buddhist community in Vietnam. And we wanted to represent the mass of people who did not have a voice. They did not have a chance to speak out. So we live as a community in Paris. And our office in a poor quarter of Paris, number 11, La Goutte d'Or Street. And that quarters were inhabited more by the people of Arab origin. Every time I applied for a visa to go to America, it was turned down automatically. They didn't want me to come to America because they believe that I may be harmful, I may be an obstacle for the war efforts in Vietnam. I was not allowed to go to America, I was not allowed to go to England. Every time I wanted to go to America to on a speaking tour, I had to write a letter to someone like Senator McGovern or Senator Robert Kennedy, asking them to send me a letter of invitation. The letter is something like this, Dear Thich Nhat Hanh, I would like to know more about the situation of the war in Vietnam. Please come and inform me. And if you have difficulties concerning the visa, please telephone me at this number. Only with such a letter that I could have a visa. Otherwise, there's no way. I remember one day I flew from Japan back to Paris. I did not have a visa. For transit in Seattle. I flew from Tokyo to New York via Seattle and then to Paris. I want to stop in New York in order to meet with a friend in the peace movement, Alfred Hassler of the Fellowship of Reconciliation. And when I landed in Seattle, well, I was locked in a place where I could not see anyone. I look around and see many pictures and wanted. They took my passport. They didn't allow me to be in touch with anyone. And then when the plane is about to take off, they gave my passport back. It's very difficult. One day when I was in Washington, D.C., I told you already, the Baltimore Sun, a reporter came and informed me that there's a dispatch from Saigon informing the government of the United States of America, of France, of England, United Kingdom, and of Japan asking them not to honor the passport of Thich Nhat Hanh, because he has been saying things that are not helpful to the world efforts against communism. And in Vietnam, my books, my articles, my poetry was banned by both the communist and the anti-communist. I risk deportation and put in jail because of what I have done, calling for peace and speaking against the war. It was my intention to go only for 3 months to give a series of lectures in Cornell and then to make a tour of America and Europe and go home. I was working with my friends in a school of youth for social service, the Van Hanh Buddhist University that I founded, had helped found it in 64. All my friends, co-workers were in Vietnam. I didn't want to go very long. I intended to come here only for 3 months. But it has been 38 years already. I have not been able to go home, 38 years. And that is why I have been sharing the practice with friends in Europe, in America, in other countries. But because I have found my true home, I don't suffer. The truth is that during the first year of my being exiled, it was difficult, quite difficult. Although I was already 40, although I was already a Dharma teacher, having many monks and nuns as students, disciples, and yet I had not found my true home. I can give very good lectures on Buddhism, on the practice of Buddhism. But I had not truly arrived. Intellectually, well, I had a lot of Buddhism. I had been trained several years in a Buddhist institute and practicing since the time I was 16. And during the time I was a young monk, I tried my best to renew Buddhism, update Buddhism, so that Buddhism can respond to the real situation of suffering, called engaged Buddhism. The kind of Buddhism that can offer you the answers to the burning question of society. Questions like war, social injustice, political suppression, poverty, violence, and so on. It was very difficult for me during the first 2 years, because my intention was to bring about information to the world, the kind of information that were not available to people, because the warring parties, they had all the mass media. And in speaking to her, I slept one or two nights in each city, in America, in Europe, in Australia, and so on. There were times when I woke up in the night, I did not know where I was. Very difficult, very hard. And after, well, I had to breathe in and out and to find out where I was, what city, what country. And I dreamt of going home to my root temple in central Vietnam, climbing a hill, a green hill, beautiful trees. And half the way to the top of the hill, I woke up and realized that I was in exile. And the same kind of dream repeated again and again. I was very active. I was making friends with many people, Catholic priests, Protestant ministers, professors, young people, children. And my practice was a practice of mindfulness. I try to live in the here and the now and touch the wonders of life in my daily life. I survive with that practice. The trees in Europe were so different from the trees in Vietnam. The fruits, the flowers, they are all different. And the people also. So I learned to make friends with and play with German children, French children, American children, British children. I make friends with Anglican priests, Catholic priests, Protestant ministers, and so on. But thanks to that practice, I was able to find my true home in the here and the now. And I stopped suffering, and the dream did not come back anymore. People think that I suffer when I cannot go back to Vietnam, but that's not the case. If I go to Vietnam, that would be a joy to be able to offer the teaching to the monks, the nuns, the lay people there, and talk to the artists, to the writers and others. But if I cannot go, I don't have to suffer. I can meet with other people in other countries, like in China, in Korea, in Japan, in Spain, in England, in Canada, and so on. And the formula, I have arrived. I am home. Is the embodiment, the expression of my practice. It expresses my understanding of the teaching of the Buddha. It is the cream of my practice. I have arrived, I am home. And since the time I have found my true home, I don't suffer. I did not suffer anymore. The past is no longer a prison for me. The future is no longer a prison for me. I'm able to live in the here and the now. I'm able to touch my true home. I know that the future is available through the present. This is what I have found. When you touch the present moment deeply, you touch the past. And if you know how to handle the present moment properly, you heal the past. Many think that the past is already gone, you cannot do anything. You cannot go back to the past and fix things and repair things. But according to this teaching of the Buddha, the past is still there with all the pain and suffering. And if you know how to come home to the present moment and touch the present moment deeply, you touch the past and you can heal the past. And when you heal yourself, you heal your ancestors. And this is possible. My ancestors have suffered in me. I have also suffered. And since I am able to touch the present moment deeply, I heal myself and I heal my ancestors, including my parents, my father, my mother, my brother, my sister, my grandfather, my grandmother. When I practice walking, I generate the energy of freedom and solidity. And I feel that all my ancestors enjoy the freedom and the solidity that I generate with the practice of walking. Because to me, my ancestors are always alive in me, fully present in me, in every cell of my body. And if I am free, they are free. If I am healed, they are healed. When I take a step with solidity and freedom, all of them take that step with me. And you have to take that step with all your being. Full awareness, full concentration, in order for that step to be really solid, to be free, in order for you to be able to touch life, the wonders of life in that moment, that is healing and nourishing. So the act of making a step is an act of freedom, an act of liberation. You liberate yourself, you liberate your ancestors. It's an act of revolution. Please believe me. You cannot make such a step unless you invest entirely your body and your mind. 100%. When you breathe in, you bring all yourself together, body and mind. You become one. And equipped with that energy of mindfulness and concentration, you make a step. And you have the insight that this is your true home. This is you are alive, you are fully present, you are touching life as a reality. Your true home is not an abstract idea. It is a solid reality that you can touch with your feet, with your hand, and with your mind. The kingdom of God, or the Pure Land of the Buddha, for me, they are not abstract ideas. That is something you can touch in every moment, you can live in every moment. It is available in the here and the now. If you know how to make yourself available, And then the kingdom is available. The pure land is available. Your true home is available. And nobody can take away your true home. They can occupy your country, yes. They can put you in prison, yes. But they cannot take away your true home and your freedom. So it's very important, it's very fundamental, it's very basic that you touch your true home, that you realize your true home in the here and the now. And the energy with which you can do so is mindfulness and concentration. And these are energies of the Buddha. All of us have the seed of mindfulness and concentration in us. This is something, this is a fact. Because all of us are capable of drinking our tea mindfully. When I drink my tea, I want to really drink my tea. I may like to breathe in order to bring my mind home to my body and establish myself fully in the here and the now. You have to be there, fully. And when you are there fully, the tea will be there for you fully. If you are not there, the tea is just something like a ghost, not very real. Mindfulness helps you to become fully present and fully alive in the here and the now. And it does not take long. It may take just one step, one in-breath. And by making a step or breathing in, you bring your mind back to your body. In your daily life, your body may be here, but your mind may be there. They go into different directions. And you are in a state of distraction. Mind and body away from each other. Your mind may be occupied, preoccupied by your project, your fear, your anger. Caught in the past, caught in the future. But between your mind and your body, there is something. Your breath. And as soon as you go home to your breath and you breathing in, I know I am breathing in. And then your body and your mind come together very quickly. While breathing in, you don't think of anything. You just focus your attention to your in-breath. You focus, you invest 100% of yourself into your in-breath. You become your in-breath. There is a concentration, mindfulness of your in-breath, concentration and your in-breath that will make body and mind coming together in just one moment. And suddenly you become fully present, fully alive. And in that state of being, you pick up your tea and the tea become a reality. Not a ghost. And when you drink your tea, you are just drinking your tea. That's called mindful drinking. There's no thinking. There's just drinking, deep drinking. You are real, and the tea is real. And when you are real, the tea is real, life is real. And many people live in a dream because they are not in the present moment. They don't know what is going on in the present moment. But because you are able to bring your mind back to your body, you are fully present and you become aware of what is going on. What is going on is that I enjoy my tea. There's no drinking at all. There is no thinking at all. There's only drinking of tea. In that moment, I live deeply the moment of drinking my tea. When I breathe in, I become fully aware of my in-breath. My in-breath becomes the object of mindfulness. My in-breath becomes the object of my concentration. And that is why my body comes home to my mind comes home to my body right away. And I become fully present. Suppose you, a group of people, stand there and contemplate a beautiful sunset. If you keep thinking about the past, or thinking about the future and your project, you are not really there contemplating the sunset. The sunset is not for you. So if you practice breathing in and out become available in the here and now, and this beautiful sunset is for you. Breathing in, I know the sunset is there. Breathing out, I smile to the beautiful sunset. In that moment, life is real. And you have your truth. When you might go back to the present moment, you might encounter the wonders of life that are refreshing and healing. You might encounter suffering, violence, hate, fear, discrimination. And if you are a good practitioner, you have enough mindfulness in order to handle whatever need to be handled. Suppose anger is coming up in you as an energy. As a practitioner, you don't allow anger to be alone in you. Because if you let anger to be alone in you, anger will cause a lot of damage in your body, in your mind, and maybe around you. That is why we practice mindfulness of anger. Breathing in, I know anger is in me. Breathing out, I smile to my anger. embrace my anger. You have a seed of anger deep in yourself. But you also have a seed of mindfulness deep in yourself. You have a seed of compassion in yourself. When anger is touched, when the seed of anger is touched, it manifests into a kind of energy called anger. Suppose this is your consciousness, and it has two layers. The lower layer is called store consciousness, and the upper layer is called mind consciousness. You have a seed of anger here. You also have a seed of joy, of mindfulness, of compassion, of non-discrimination. You have a seed of anger, of despair, of jealousy, of discrimination in the depth of your consciousness. But when the seed of anger is left alone there, in the store consciousness, you don't water it, no one come and touch it, you are okay. You can laugh, may have a good time. But that does not mean that you don't have the seed of anger in you. As soon as you hear someone saying something or doing something, the seed of anger in you is touched. And it becomes a zone of energy in the realm of mind consciousness. In Buddhism, we call it a mental formation. Anger is a mental formation. In my tradition, we speak of 51 categories of mental formations. We have a seed of discrimination in us. We have a seed of non-discrimination in us. That is true. If the seed of discrimination is water every day, it becomes very important. And it doesn't allow the seed of non-discrimination to manifest. If the seed of anger becomes stronger and stronger every day, the seed of compassion have less chance. And that is why every time a negative seed is touched and manifest, we have to take care of it. That is why I spoke about mindfulness of anger. When mindfulness is the capacity of knowing what is happening is anger has manifest. So as a practitioner, you ask the seed of mindfulness to manifest at the same time. And if you are a diligent practitioner, the seed of mindfulness in you is strong enough, and it's very easy for you to touch and invite it to come up. And it come up, become a zone of energy. Suppose anger is energy one, mindfulness is energy two. Mindfulness is mindfulness of something. And here, mindfulness of anger. Mindfulness here has the following function: recognizing. Anger as anger. Mindfulness of breathing. Breathing in, I know this is my in-breath. Breathing out, I know this is my out-breath. Recognizing in-breath as in-breath. Recognizing out-breath as out-breath. Recognizing drinking as a drinking. Recognizing walking as a walking. That's the nature, the function of mindfulness. So the energy of mindfulness generated by your breathing, your walking, has the capacity of recognizing anger as anger. Breathing in, I know anger is in me. Breathing out, I take good care of my anger. Recognizing anger and embracing anger. This is an art. This is a practice. There's no fighting. Mindfulness is generated not to fight anger, but to recognize anger and to hold anger very tenderly. That is Buddhist practice. You do not transform yourself into a battlefield, the good fighting the evil. That's not Buddhism. Because you are mindfulness, but you are also anger. And mindfulness plays the role of a big sister, holding the angry, the suffering younger sister, and help her to transform. A mother who's working in the kitchen, and she hears the baby crying, and she very much cares for her baby. So she stopped walking in the kitchen. She put down whatever she's holding and she goes to the room of the baby. And the first thing she does is to pick up the baby and hold the baby tenderly into her arms. That's the mother. She does not know what is wrong with the baby yet, but the first thing she does is to pick up the baby and hold her mindfully. We do the same thing as a practitioner. Every time anger or despair come up, we generate the energy of mindfulness in order to recognize and to embrace tenderly. Tenderly. And if we know how to practice mindful walking or mindful breathing, we continue to generate mindfulness. And we have that energy in order to recognize and to embrace. And we can bring a relief. Because mindfulness as an energy, embracing anger as another source of energy, tenderly. Big brother, younger brother. Although the mother has not realized what is wrong with the baby, but the fact that she is holding the baby tenderly can already bring a relief to the baby, and the baby may stop crying. And if the mother continues to hold the baby tenderly with mindfulness, she'll find out what is wrong. The baby may be hungry, the baby may have a fever, or the diaper may be too tight. As a mother, she can find it out very quickly. As a practitioner, you can find out very easily why this anger. And you can see the roots of that anger. You find out the nature of that anger, the root of that anger. If the mother found out what is wrong with the baby, she can fix the situation very quickly. If the baby is hungry, she gave her some milk. If the diaper is too tight, she just undo it and do it again. So after having embraced tenderly your anger, you might like to continue the practice of mindful breathing, the practice of mindful walking, and look deeply into the nature of your anger and find out what is the root of your anger. recognizing, embracing, and looking deeply. Because mindfulness is the kind of energy that carrying with her the energy of concentration. Wherever mindfulness is, concentration is also. When you are mindful of your in-breath, you are concentrated in your in-breath. When you are mindful of your tea, you concentrate on the tea. And that is why the more powerful mindfulness is, the more concentration you get. And with that mindfulness and concentration, you practice looking deeply and you get insight. And that insight is going to liberate you, transform your anger. There is a story of a young boy who used to come to Plum Village every summer with his younger sister. And they practiced mindfulness as children. The boy had difficulty with his father. He blamed his father. Every time he fell down and got hurt, his father always shouted at him instead of coming and help him. So his relationship with his father was difficult. And he vowed that when he grew up, he would not be like his father. If he has children and then if his child fell down and got hurt, he will not shout at him. Instead, he will come and try to help. That is his determination. One day, he was in the lower hamlet, the Plum Village, and her sister, while playing with another little girl on the hammock, fell down and got hurt. And the blood was coming down. Suddenly, he found himself very angry. He wanted to shout, "Stupid! How could you come? How could you do something like that?" And because he had been practicing mindfulness, he was able to refrain from shouting. And he recognized that he was exactly like his father. Instead of trying to come and help his sister, he had the tendency to shout at her. He hates what he has within himself. So when he practiced mindful breathing, he knew that this is a continuation of his father inside of him. He is not different from his father. And with that insight, he turned around and practiced slow walking when he had seen someone coming to help his sister. And during slow walking, he recognized that he's a continuation of his father. The energy of anger has been transmitted by his father. And if he does not practice, he is going to become exactly like his father. And he will treat his children in the future in the same way. That is called samsara, continuation. And suddenly he had a desire that he had to go home and tell his father that he has exactly the same kind of energy and he would invite his father to practice with him. And when that intention was born in him, his anger, resentment toward his father began to dissolve. What kind of insight did he get? He got the insight that he is exactly like his father. He has the same kind of habit energy. And that is why he wanted to practice. And he see himself as a victim of that energy, victim of the transmission of that habit energy. And he saw that his father also was a victim of that transmission. His father might have got it from his own father. And when he had that insight, his anger vis-à-vis his father just stopped. He got a transformation. I think for a young man of 12, that is a remarkable achievement. It is insight that transforms our afflictions. And mindfulness has the power of recognizing, embracing, looking deeply, getting the insight that transforms you, that get you free. Transformation and healing and freedom. And when the young man is liberated, the father in him was liberated, and the ancestors in him are liberated. He end the circle, the round of samsara. What the young man realized is that he's not a victim of his father. He's a victim of that habit energy. And his father also is a victim of that habit energy. And when you are able to transform you are in a situation to help transform him or her. The one that you have believed that to be your oppressor, the source of your suffering. And that is my practice. I do not have enemies. Even they have created a lot of suffering, a lot of injustice. They have tried to kill me, to suppress me. But they are not my enemies. They are those I want to help. Because I have become free. I have changed myself. I have transformed myself. That's why I do not longer see myself as a victim. I know that if I can transform myself, I can transform them. I can help transform them. If you practice, and if you can transform your mind, your heart, you become a bodhisattva. And then you will be in a position to help them transform those you used to consider as oppressors. Abusers, those who consider to be the one who discriminate against you, trying to suppress you and kill you and so on. They are also victims of their own ignorance, their own anger. They don't know how to handle their craving, their anger, their violence, their fear. So the path is to transform yourself into a bodhisattva with plenty of understanding, insight, and compassion. And when you have these energies, you are free. And you are in a position of helping other people to become free also. This is the path shown to us by the Buddha. And as every one of us has the seat of mindfulness, concentration, and insight in himself or in herself, you are able to cultivate these three kinds of energies for our own liberation and healing. And we shall use the same kind of energies to help the transformation and healing of the world. When you look up, you see a temple. The temple is in your heart, the lotus in your heart. And underneath there was the word Smriti. Smriti means mindfulness. And then there is the word Samadhi, it means concentration. And there is the word Prajna, that is insight. And that is the kind of energy that are in us to be cultivated, to develop. That is the energy of the Buddha in us. The energy of transformation and healing. During our retreat, we practice mindful breathing, mindful walking. And that is why we are encouraged to use our time for the practice. If we talk a lot, there will be no time to enjoy our in-breath, our breath, our walking. There will be time when we are encouraged to talk to each other, Dharma discussions. We will be sharing our insight, our way of overcoming our suffering. And when we practice eating our lunch or our breakfast, we refrain from thinking. We establish ourselves in the here and the now. And we pay attention only to the food that we eat. When we pick up a piece of bread, we do not think of the past, of the future. We just touch the piece of bread deeply. And we are able to see that the piece of bread. So if you look deeply into the piece of bread, you see everything in it. And the piece of bread you hold in your hand is the body of the cosmos. And with a little bit of mindfulness, you can see that the piece of bread is an ambassador for the form of the cosmos coming to you. And if you can see the piece of bread in its true nature, and then you can put it in your mouth. Don't put anything else in your mouth, like your projects, your fear, your anger. It's not healthy. Just put the bread. And when you chew the bread, just chew the bread mindfully with joy. Don't chew your sorrow, your anger. It's not good for your health. There's no thinking, just the practice of mindfulness is chewing. And we take our time to enjoy our breakfast. From time to time, we pose and smile. The brother in front of you is you. The sister on your left is you. They all belong to the Sangha. And together, we generate the mindfulness of the energy of mindfulness. The collective energy of mindfulness while walking, while sitting, while eating will be powerful. And it will penetrate into each of us. We'll be healed by the collective energy and nourished by the collective energy. Alone in our living room, we can generate the energy of mindfulness. But compared to the collective energy of mindfulness, well, it's not much. Therefore, to be in a Sangha and to allow ourselves to be penetrated by the collective energy of mindfulness with Sangha is very important. So the coming together of a Sangha is a very important fact. It's a miracle. And we should profit from the opportunity. Allow ourselves to be transported by the collective energy of Sangha. Allow the Sangha to embrace our afflictions, our pain, our sorrow. The Sangha is the boat that helps you to float on the river of suffering. Allow yourself to be transported by the Sangha, by the collective energy of mindfulness. And while eating, you enjoy the time being with the Sangha. You smile to your brother and sister in the practice. You allow yourself to be nourished by the collective energy of the Sangha. And every moment of our daily life, our mindfulness helps us to be in the here and the now. And the real practice, the true practice, is to allow every moment of our daily life to be a joyful moment. That will be possible thanks to the power of mindfulness and concentration generated by yourself and generated by Sadhya Sangha. Tomorrow we shall have mindfulness walk in the morning. We shall be walking together. We walk in such a way that make the kingdom of God real, available in the here and the now. That several of us are very used to the practice. We will walk together and generate the collective energy of mindfulness together. And you see that the kingdom, the Pure Land, is available.